Hey there! Is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible because it's the divinely inspired Word of God and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today, and we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
This is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will enter in His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter in His courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will enter in His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter in His courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made.
On November 3rd, 86 out of 99 state legislative chambers are holding elections.
There are 70 million young eligible voters, the largest and most diverse generation in our country's history.
We have the power to shape our country and communities,
but we need all of us.
So picture this.
On November 3rd, we choose.
We choose who sits in 435 seats in the House of Representatives.
We choose 24 senators and 13 governors.
We choose the sheriffs, the DAs, and the judges too.
With 70 million young eligible voters, we choose to align a vision too humane to be political.
And make the future prouder than it's ever been.
So when the alarm goes off on Tuesday, November 3rd, 2020, and you arrive at your polling site, to see freedom clocking two-hour waits.
Vote anyway.
When the machines stop working and your job starts calling because American democracy is running late again,
vote anyway.
Your vote is bigger than the color of your state.
It is a revolution in motion.
The moment you took to the streets and to the screens to share your outrage,
you recommitted to our collective dream, which requires that you lift it out of hashtags and into DC and your communities.
Because remember, this is the same year that brought a pandemic which disproportionately killed Black and Brown Americans and Indigenous people.
The same 2020 that took the breath of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Nina Pop, and Dominique Fells.
So on November 3rd, 2020.
Know that voter suppression will be present.
Vote anyway. You will be discouraged.
Vote anyway.
Tuesday will be imperfect.
Vote anyway.
When every headline is shouting democracy and duty and swing states.
You will be asked to believe in a dream that never came to fruition for every American. And despite your best reason,
you must uphold it. Because we can't vote a world into existence that we can't first imagine.
The American dream is ours for the making.
Come alive for ancestors who need you to finish their story.
A story that begs for atonement.
Cast your promise.
Cast your promise. Cast your vote.
Cast your vote.
But vote!
Walk with thee, just a closer 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 walk with thee. Grand to thee.
Thank you. I always love it when you take us back, and I can see from the chat that I am not alone. Thank you, Alice, for reminding us that a prayer that we might just have just a closer walk with God sometimes is all we need to make everything all right. This week, I was led to leave the lectionary. The lectionary is the text. The weekly text from which I usually select my sermon text as the Spirit leads. But with everything going on, God led me in search of some comfort food to help sustain us this week. So if you would open up your Bible or the memory verses in your heart to the 23rd Psalm and follow along with me this morning as we journey through the valley. Come on and be the preacher this morning, God, because you are the only one who can reach us in the valley. Hear the word of the Lord. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I want to focus this morning on verse 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. With our attention on the subject for just a few minutes, journey through the valley. Journey through the valley. As we sit here today in worship, each one of us finds ourselves in the valley of the shadow of death. Death is looming over us like toxic air filled with smoke and ash. Death is rushing towards us like frightened white men armed with AK-47s or like a raging forest fire. Death is shaking under our feet like an earthquake and nipping at our noses like a coronavirus droplet. We find ourselves in the valley of the shadow of death. We wake each morning to the news of another person taken from us too soon. We are growing accustomed to seeing that over 1,000 people died the prior day from a virus. People who were known and loved by someone, people who were essential as part of the makeup of some community. We've grown accustomed to another shooting, another set of lies, another socially distanced day of living with the intention of not catching and not spreading a disease that could kill us or those we love. We are in the valley of the shadow of death. And I don't know about you, but I know a few folks who are growing weary and beginning to believe they should or they might just lay down and die in the valley. I know some folk who are looking at all this death and starting to fear evil. They're starting to fear that they or we will not make it through this valley. People are fearing the unknown and unseen evils that await us as we keep journeying through the valley. And we're starting to become overwhelmed. Studies and scientists are trying to track the impact of all of this on our mental health. And it is clear that anxiety and depression and panic attacks and general mental unwellness are suffocating some of God's people in this valley as we wonder how long will it be until we can come out from under the shadow of death? What will happen in the next part of the journey in the valley? Who will live and who will die? And how will we personally manage this valley in the shadow of death? What will be expected of me in the valley? Is there still a through the valley or is this the end? Are we all gonna die here? Fears are rising as we approach the election in this country and as the storms rage and climates change and diseases spread across the globe. Oh God, we are hungry for some comfort food this morning. We need a word of assurance that only you can provide because we trust no one else. And sometimes, God, we're not even sure if we really trust you. Because it's dark in the valley this morning.
Thank you, Jesus.
And all of our protective systems seem to be collapsing. The ozone layer, the Supreme Court, the economy, and even our family systems are shaken in the darkness of this isolation in the valley. And God, we need you to speak to us where we need to hear it. We need you, God, to feed us where we're hungry. We need you to lead us beside still waters where we're thirsty. We need some comfort food as we attempt to keep going on the journey through the valley of the shadow of death. Can you talk to us, David? Can you tell us something that will help us make it through the valley? Comfort food is food that provides consolation or a feeling of well-being. It typically comes with a high sugar content or other high carbohydrate content, and it's usually associated in our minds with childhood or home cooking. Comfort food, you know what I mean, like biscuits and gravy, catfish and grits, fried chicken and mac and cheese, pancakes and sausage. You can place your favorite comfort food in the chat. For those of us who grew up in church, and even for some who did not, the 23rd Psalm is our comfort food. It reminds us that we have a good shepherd who will ensure that we are never left wanting that he knows where the green pastures and the still waters can be found, even in the midst of chaos, and he is able to prepare a table before us in the presence of those who would rather see us starve. The 23rd Psalm is comfort food for the weary soul on a long journey through the valley of the shadow of death. Can I get a witness? This food has the power to restore and refresh our souls, to reach us when we have wandered onto the wrong path, because goodness and mercy have been assigned to keep track of us all the days of our lives. And if our flesh does not make it through this valley, the 23rd Psalm comforts us in knowing that we have a home not made with human hands, and surely we will dwell in the house of the Lord eternally. The 23rd Psalm reminds us that God knows what we need, and God will anoint our heads with oil as only God can do. And we will not run out, our cups will run over with enough to share. Comfort food helps us when we are trying to journey through the valley, y'all. So I asked David, who is given credit for writing this psalm, if he had any suggestions for us in our current condition. I asked David, how can we manage the natural fears that arise when we're in the valley of the shadow of death? I'm almost done, so pay attention. This is what he said. First, when you are in a valley, your perception can get thrown off. So David said, stay focused. A valley is a depression in the land, so that you may have mountains behind you and mountains in front of you. And you can begin to feel trapped, like there is no way out. But David says, when we are in a valley, we must remember to look to the hills from whence cometh our help. Our help cometh from the Lord. And though we may not be able to see what is following behind us or what lies ahead, our God sits high and looks low and can and will lead us in right paths for his name's sake. So David says, stay focused. Shadows are only visible in the presence of light. Focus on the light. God is with us. Be not afraid in the valley, because God can see what we cannot see. All we need to do is focus on the light and trust that God will lead us in the way we should go. Don't get freaked out. Remember, God sees what we cannot see. Second, David says, when you are journeying through the valley of the shadow of death, tell them, Francine, keep moving. This message is called Journey Through the Valley, Not Settle in the Valley. Amen? No matter what has happened or what unfolds in the days ahead, David reminds us that we must keep moving forward. We must keep climbing through the valley. We can take the rest we need because our good shepherd can help us find some green pastures where we can rest for a minute. But then we need to drink from the still waters. We need to take some nourishment from the word of God. And we need to take up our mat and begin to keep on walking through the valley. I know that we are tired. I know the journey has been long, and it seems like we've been through these valleys before, and we've fought these fights before, and it feels like we're moving backwards and moving into deeper, darker valleys. But God says, resist the pull to give up. Keep moving forward. Do not lose hope. The promise in our is that God can restore what the locusts have eaten. God can undo some stuff that the enemy has put in place. God can rearrange, just like we said in our church school lesson this morning, what the enemy has meant for good to destroy us. Imagine all the plans of the wicked that have been plotted and planned by Stephen Miller and all of these white supremacists trying to take God's country out of God's people's hands. And remember what can happen when God takes what is meant for evil and uses it for our good. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We have much to stand on. We are on Christ, the solid rock. Keep moving forward. We don't have permission to lay down and die in the valley. Finally, David says, when you are feeling most afraid and the battle ahead seems too big for you to fight, remember that the battle is not yours. It's the Lord's. We don't have to fight alone. God never assigned us to be the one who defeats evil. Thank you, Jesus. Our shepherd has a rod and a staff, and they are used to protect and guide us through dangerous territories. Our shepherd has promised his Father that he will not lose any one of us who belong to him. Remember, when you start to feel afraid, that the battle between good and evil is a battle between God and the enemy. And God wins this battle. The battle is bloody and ugly, and there is suffering and sorrow. And it is true that the servants of God take some hits. Remember Calvary. But God does win. And we are not the only servants in the struggle either. David says, remind the people and remind yourself, Francine, that there are many believers who are waiting to do their part in the struggle. Instead of worrying about ammunition to prepare for a civil war, David says, get out your knee pads and get to praying so that you will be available for however God wants to use you in battle. Get out your knee pads because God may be getting ready to arm you with healing from your lips. Get out your knee pads because God might be able to anoint your hand for healing. And when somebody is getting ready to shoot, you might be asked just to touch them on the shoulder and God will deliver them from what's happening to them. Get out your knee pads and fight like a real Christian soldier fights. You don't have to fight the whole fight. You are not personally responsible for defeating evil. God will protect us. We need only meet God in the secret place and carry out our personal assignment. Don't be scared. Don't be overwhelmed. Don't take responsibility for the whole battle. Go on and get your rest when you need to rest. Go on and get in your prayer closet when you need to get in your prayer closet. Take the day off work and get your mind right. Get your spirit right. Trust that the battle is not yours. It belongs to God. God will bring us through the valley, saints. Take a deep breath. Let the comfort food of the 23rd Psalm digest in your spirit. Rest up, and then let's keep moving, y'all. We got to stay on the journey together and get out of Death Valley. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Cut me over. Great Jehovah.
This is your invitation. This is your prayer.
Yes. But thou art mine.
mighty. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You're so mighty. Hold me with thy power. This is the part I like. Bread of heaven.
Bread of heaven, bread of heaven.
Feed me till I won't.
Feed me till I want no more.
I won't want no more. Oh yeah. I said bread of heaven.
Hallelujah.
Bread of heaven. Bread of heaven.
How many of you know that the more you give to God, the more God gives to you? And what about this, that you really cannot beat God giving, no matter how you try? You ever heard that before? You ever taken God at God's word and tried God? This is our opportunity now to see if God's word is true. If we bring the full tithe into the storehouse and put God to the test, will God take care of us even during a global pandemic when the economy is down and tragedy is commonplace and people are suffering all around? Why don't we try and see if we get a testimony from our tithing? Why don't you take a moment now and get your checkbook out and get ready to write your check so that you can mail it in to Bethel AME Church, P.O. Box 2236, Fontana, California, 92334. Again, if you're mailing a check, it's to Bethel AME Church, P.O. Box 2236, Fontana, California, 92334. You also have a host of electronic giving choices. You can use Cash App at Bethel AME Fontana, or use Givelify at Bethel AME Fontana, or use PayPal at BethelAMEFontana.org and use the donate button on our website. So again, our handle at Cash App and Givelify is Bethel AME Fontana. You can also visit our website at BethelAMEFontana.org. Now listen. God wants us to test God in this one area and see if God won't open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings that we don't have room enough to receive. It is true. The more we give, the more God gives to us. Thank you so much for giving back to God what God has given to you.